Hey guys, it's Lazar here again, back with another video on a few technical tips that I think all of you should know if you've been teaching with BOXFiSH for some time now. So, before I begin, I just want to say that I'm really happy that I helped you with my first video, and I got a lot of comments asking me about which headset am I using and what would I recommend. So, first of all, this is an MPOW. I'm not sure you can see it, but it's an MPOW headset. Just a very, very standard one. It comes with a very long cable, about 1.5 meters long. And it's actually a very, very cheap and durable device. So if you go on Amazon or pretty much, you know, any retail store, you'll be able to find something like this. I've personally been using this for about a year now, and it's really, really good. Be warned, though, the noise cancellation, the microphone, won't really be picked up by all devices. So some devices, mostly iOS devices, will pick up the microphone and the noise cancellation built in. And some devices, like most Android phones, won't really be able to distinguish the microphone part. So it's best to just do a sound test to see if, you know, something outside can be heard when you're using the headset. There's been a lot of misconceptions about what actually helps you get classes. And for the last 2 years or so, ever since I started working on BOXFiSH, I've seen a lot of people asking these questions. And my answer to these questions all the time is always the same, because I've actually tried it out for myself, and I'm pretty sure that this is how it works. So the main determinant of the number of classes you'll be getting is the number of slots that you've opened into the future. So the thing is, the more slots you open up further into the future you open them up, the more classes you will get. So I always open up my slots about a month and a half in advance. I don't want to open up, you know, slots 4 or 5 months in advance, because I just want to be sure that I can make all of them, you know, that I can actually attend them. So if you know that you have something important planned maybe next month or in 2 months' time, but you don't know the exact date, try not to open those slots unless you're 100% sure, or at least, you know, 95% sure you'll be able to make it. It's very important to be able to attend all of the classes you open up, but opening up your slots far in advance gives students time to plan. And this is especially important when it comes to Chinese students. They like consistency. They like to be able to depend on the same teacher at the same time, doing the same things that they love doing, learning English. So that's tip number one. Tip number two, I'm still not sure that that'll help me get classes. How do I get even more classes? So you've probably seen this function, right? You've probably seen the live function on the app, and you're probably wondering, well, yeah, I've used it. I open up, you know, I sign up for it, I click the button, and I'm still not getting any classes. I get a notification sometimes on my lock screen, but I don't get any students. What's up with that? So here's the key thing, and it took me a lot to find out how to do this effectively. When you get a notification that a student is waiting for a class or something like that while you're in the live standby mode, the class might be taken by another tutor whose phone was on while the student was you know, calling. So the live class is best used while having your phone awake. So how do I have my phone awake all the time? I can't, you know, I can't look at my phone all the time. It's very simple. So on iPhones and on most Android devices, the process is pretty much the same. You go on settings, right? And I'm not sure you can really see this, but the idea is you go to display and brightness. Whoops. Okay, so display and brightness. And there's this option that says auto lock, right? So auto lock is basically a screen timeout. By default, I think it's set on 30 seconds or 1 minute. And what this basically means is that your phone will go to sleep. And if it goes to sleep, the notifications take longer to arrive. And someone else might take the class, or the student, won't be interested or something like that. I'm not really sure how it works, but what I do know is that if you set your auto lock on never and, open up the standby function, the live standby function, when you can actually attend it, this will keep your phone on. Basically, it will be on this screen forever until you manually turn it off by the power button. So what's important is to do this, set your phone's brightness maybe to medium or minimum, it doesn't really matter, and make sure that your notification sounds, your ringer, is on. Why? So that you can hear when you get a class. So what happens is that your phone will be like this. It'll be awake for more than 30 or 1 minute, more than 30 seconds or 1 minute, and you will be able to just get the class right away. There will be a jingle played, a very, very loud jingle most of the time, and you will be able to attend the live class. You will be getting the live class sooner, right? You don't need to, open your phone, press, get back into the app, and do all those things. So this is important if you want to have live classes. I'm sure it works the same on Android. I just showed you how to do it on iOS. So feel free to give it a try and tell me if it helped you. Okay, so tip number 3, using WeChat to communicate. So you obviously know as an older teacher that WeChat is the primary source of information, especially when it comes to classes. So something that you might not know is that you can actually use WeChat on your laptop or desktop. So this is very, very important. It's something that I've actually realized maybe a bit later than I should have, because it really ended up saving me a lot of time in the long run. So basically, whether it's Windows or Macintosh, you can have WeChat. You can have the WeChat app on your computer. So in order to do that, just download WeChat. You can download it on the WeChat website or in the Apple Store if you're using a Mac, and authenticate it with your phone. So no matter which device you're using WeChat on, it doesn't even need to be the same one that you're running BoxFiSH on. It's completely up to you. You just need to verify very, very quickly, verify that this is your phone, and voila, you will have a WeChat client on your desktop. So why is this important? Well, sometimes you might be assigned a class, and sometimes you need to respond very quickly. So imagine this, you're getting a class, you actually got a live class, and you're waiting for the materials, for the slides to download. And in the meantime, BoxFiSH is asking you on WeChat if everything is going okay, is the download progressing, and you don't want to exit out of the download to respond on your phone. So just have it on your desktop and you can respond very quickly. Another thing, tip number 4, is to keep your storage, right, your free space on your phone at a very decent level. So this is a 16 gigabyte iPhone, right? Nothing special. But if you want your apps to run nicely, you need to be able to install all of the slides and have them preloaded when you get a live class or a sudden class, and just, be able to react right away. So sometimes the app might not run as well as it did before. Usually, it's recommended to just clear the cache. But sometimes, especially in my case, and again, this is a very old phone, it's not really necessary. The thing that actually makes the app slower, at least on iOS, is the lack of free storage, because the iPhone system also uses storage for different things like swap file, making it run better when it has low RAM and stuff like that. I won't get too technical, but basically, try to use a phone where there's more than 30 or maybe 25% free space. So if you have 12 gigabytes of actual usable free space, try to make it so that not more than 10 is used, by all apps combined. Tip number five, running devices on a charger really helps. You might have heard about this on the news. Again, this is only for iOS users, but I think it helps Android users as well. Sometimes a phone will throttle down the power. What that means is that the app will run worse, but it's not actually because of the app, it's because of the phone. And the reason why it's doing that is because it's trying to conserve power, get into a low power mode or a battery savings mode. And the thing that actually can help prevent that is just by having the phone plugged in. So try investing in a longer USB cable, a longer cord. It really, really helps. Also, another thing, try having your phone on a stable surface. No one likes a wobbly camera. Imagine if I'm always talking to a student like this. It's not professional. Sure, it's manageable. It's okay. You can probably, have a good class with it. But standing your phone, putting it on some sort of a stand or against something, can make the video stable and professional. Trust me, you'll want students to do that as well. But the most important tip of all is to use props. So a prop can be anything. You don't need to go out of your way and make special things for students like toys, puppets. Sure, that's a good idea, but pretty much anything is a prop these days. You don't even know how many students respond so well to this Happy Meal toy. So this Happy Meal toy of Super Mario waving your hand when you press the button on the back makes younger students smile. When they're seeing you for the first time, they want to see a friendly face. And it's important to be able to make a good first impression. So doing something like this, it doesn't really take much effort. This is a very, very cheap Happy Meal toy. I got this pretty much randomly when I was at McDonald's one time. Can make a world of difference. So try using everything at your disposal. This is especially true later on when you get regular students that you pretty much talked about with about all things, about all the possible things that you could have talked about, and you don't know what else to do. So try to spice it up a little bit. With some of my regular students, I've actually had the most interesting conversations by just showing them random things around my room. So, for instance, a phone like this, or I don't know, a USB cable. Sometimes I have a lot of students that are into technology, and we share a common interest. So just try and show them things around. I had this one student that was really, really into technology, and as someone who is also into technology, it didn't take us a whole lot to just connect on that level. So I told him about my iPhone, and how old it was, and how it was still running well, and about all the memories I've had with this phone, and then he actually went out of his way to show me his old iPad that he also had fond memories of. So it's things like those where the teacher actually becomes the student and vice versa. You want to connect with a student on a personal level. You don't want to make it just a class. Let's do slides and wait for 25 minutes to end. No, you want it to be a conversation with a friend. So obviously with new students, it won't really work as easily. But if you have students, the same student for, two or three times now, try and find a common interest. It's very, very easy. Just try to do something different. Okay? So having anything Literally anything can serve as a teaching prop. You can do, maybe if you're doing an ecology class, right? If you're doing something about recycling or anything really, you can just, show them this bottle, right? And then you can show them this and you can ask them what's the difference. And then the student will try to tell you what is the difference between these two. Well, you have water in both. This one is made out of glass. This one is made out of plastic. And then you can open up a lot more areas to explore with your students. So it's really just things like those. Just being able to feel what is it that will make the student interested in opening up and actually taking the initiative. You want the student to actually go out of his way and express himself. And these are very, very simple things, right? Very simple things. Okay, so that's it from me. I hope this was useful to you, and I'll see you soon.